Thank you, Paul. Hey, beautiful, beautiful. There is a bomb in Gilead. Well, I'm so grateful you're here tonight. I know that we have several out sick, and I'm so grateful for all those who tuned in last week. I was really surprised at how many viewers we had on YouTube within 4 days' time. I tell you, it's, I don't know, the Lord must be impressing somebody to pass it on, but I'm grateful. Beloved, we've been talking about the love of God. And last Sunday night, our message on the power of God in the Christian life. Love never fails. Amen. You know, we close out that 13th chapter with love never fails. Whether they be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether they be tongues, they shall cease. But when that which is perfect, listen to the last part of that verse. When that which is perfect is come, that which is in part shall be done away. You know, it's a wonderful thing to live in New Testament times. Mm-hmm. Have you ever thought about that? I thought about it when I was listening to our preacher of this weekend from Johannesburg, South Africa. It's been my privilege, Darcy, some of us here at the church, to be in South Africa 7 times on mission trips. I learned to love that country. I learned to love the people. And, you know, the universal language is the language of love. You know that. And we talked a couple of weeks ago about the first commandment, love the Lord with all thy heart. The second is like unto it, love thy neighbor as thyself. We talked about the fruit of the Spirit, the fulfilling of the law. Now, you can't fulfill the law without the fruit of the Spirit, because the law commands us to have the love that Jesus had, which is unconditional, agape love. Not phileo, not eros, not storge. By the way, I'll introduce our visitor at the close of the service. I apologize, brother. We have the pastor of the pastors with us tonight. So you all be on your good behavior, all right? Now, I want to say, Don, we appreciate you you fellows being here. I want you to introduce him to us tonight, and I want you to lead us in our closing prayer, because we rejoice with every man that stands to share the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen. That was an excellent message this morning. But let me say, as we think about the first commandment, the fulfilling of the law, the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, kindness, meekness, temperance, faith. We think about the fruit. It's not plural. I mean, fruits, it's singular. The fruit of the Spirit is singular, like a grapefruit or a tangerine. Many segments, but one fruit. And a lot of people make a mistake by saying, you know, I have a lot of this and a lot of that, but you know, I'm really short on patience. Well, friend, when the love of God takes control in your heart, my heart, we have patience. When we lose our patience with each other, can't blame it on God. Amen? Amen. So I think last Sunday night was a very important message. If you weren't here or you didn't get to hear it, I hope you will pull it up on YouTube and watch it. Now, friends, listen. As we share tonight, this may be our last message with reference to love, but I had to get this one in, because there's no scripture more significant in my mind and heart through all these 70 years I've been preaching, 70 plus. There's no message that's more significant than the Lord's message to the church at Ephesus as revealed and recorded to John the Apostle. John the Beloved, the one who wrote the Gospel of John, who wrote 1st, 2nd, and 3 John, and also the book of Revelation. 5 books of the New Testament was written by John the Beloved, who stood by Jesus through all the suffering and the sorrow and the shedding of his blood on the cross. As we were reminded this morning, he stood by him. And you remember, Jesus turned to John and said, "Behold thy mother." And Doris and I had the privilege of going to Ephesus and going to the house that the archaeologists say was the home of Mary after the crucifixion of Jesus. Now here again, you know, the evidence seems to point in that direction, but it's just south of Ephesus on the map. And we had the privilege of spending the day touring Ephesus and the archaeological ruins there, and then going to the house of Mary, and then on to the Isle of Patmos where John wrote the book of Revelation. He was in exile, you remember. And boy, I want to tell you, my wife mentioned this in her Sunday school lesson. The reason it's fresh in my mind, as we were studying in here this morning from the first chapter of Revelation, that eerie supernatural something or other that we felt in that cave where the church is, that they claim where John was exiled and where he was bound in prison when he wrote the book of Revelation. And you know, I stood there and I tried to imagine what it would be like to know you would never see home again. And when, you know, as John described it, he said, "There'll be no more sea." You can look out right from in that cave just above the water there. You can look down and see the sea and the waves breaking as they come in. No more sea. The sea separated John from everything he loved in exile. You know, sometimes when the Lord gets us alone, like he did John, he can speak to us in ways that we can't explain. I had a kind of an epiphany in that cave that day, and you can't talk about it. It's too sacred to talk about. But we had just been through Ephesus, and I stood there in those really some of the most well-preserved ruins that we find in Turkey. The 7 churches are all in Turkey, you know, what modern-day Turkey. And I said, you know, we could spend a week here and we wouldn't see it all. And I tried to imagine John and the Apostle Paul in Ephesus. I wondered, when he wrote to the church at Ephesus from that position of exile, what he had on his heart. You see, I thought of that because Ephesians is my favorite book in the New Testament. And it was the first church that Jesus spoke to, the first of the 7 in the book of Revelation. And you know the first thing he talked about? "You don't love me like you used to." Now you think about that. As we think about the Lord's letter, that's my subject tonight, concerning lost love, first of all, I want you to see the words of commendation. "Write this letter," God says to John, "to the angel of the church in Ephesus." That means the messenger, the pastor, the one who speaks for me at Ephesus. Literally, the angels were the messengers or the pastor of the churches. "To the angel of the church in Ephesus, this is the message from the one who holds the 7 stars in his right hand." Now he explained it in the first chapter. This is the second chapter we're reading from now. Very first verse. That the stars are the churches. I hold the seven stars in my right hand. I'm the one who walks among the seven golden lampstands. I walk in their midst. The ones who are supposed to be letting their light shine, as we were reminded in a message this morning. I know all things that you do. This is the New Living Translation. Now listen carefully. I have seen your hard work and your patient endurance, and I know you don't tolerate evil people. Boy, you said, man, I'd like to be pastor of a church like that. Can't you imagine the deacons as they set up that morning and pastor read this letter that was addressed to him and to the church? And I could see people begin to set up, you know, very proudly and think about all their hard work, how they'd endured through great hardship, great persecution, and they can't tolerate the evil in people's lives. You have examined the claims of those. He goes further. Listen. To those who say they are apostles and are not, you have discovered that they are liars. See, the early church even had its problems. Liars in the church. Now think about it. Half a century, for all practical reasons, after Paul had written his letter to the church at Ephesus, the Lord speaks to this church through John. Let me show you what had happened. You have patiently suffered for me without quitting, but I have this complaint. See the words of commendation. Now look at the words of complaint quickly tonight. Now stay with me. What complaint did he have to this church? You don't love me or each other as you did at first. Now, what did we just read last Sunday? And the Sunday before that, we were talking about loving the Lord with all of our heart, loving our neighbors ourselves. They had trouble with the first two commandments. Paul goes on to say, he that hath loved hath fulfilled the law. We love the Lord. We do all those commandments that relate to our Lord, the four. If we love our neighbor, whether he's lost or saved, red, yellow, black, or white, makes no difference. We love him. We're going to do everything the Lord says. You know, we're going to love him. What are we going to do? We're going to do what Jesus would do in every situation. Now think about that. So you don't love the Lord, you don't love each other as you did at first. Look how far you have fallen. The King James says, look what heights, from what heights you have fallen. Turn back to me and do the first works that you did at first. These are the words of counsel. Point number three. What are the words of counsel in this letter? Remember, repent, and return. Remember from what height you have fallen. You turn around, you come back, right? You come back to first love. You love me like you did at first. And then what do? The first work. Now I'm getting to the point that I really want to emphasize tonight, because these are very familiar words to most of us. Now what is the main point here? The point is that first love and first work always go together. When you see a person that's left their first love, I'll show you a person that has left their post, so to speak, in the Christian life. They're not being faithful to share the gospel. They're not being faithful with their testimony. They're not doing what our preacher admonished us to do in the message today. They're not throwing it out there. See, whatever you have, get the message out. So first love and first work always go together. Now, I had planned to preach something else until I heard that sermon.
It was amazing.
And I thought how well this ties in with what we've been talking about, see? First love, first work, first things first. So we put the Lord first, put Him on the throne of our heart. He takes control, and the fruit of His Spirit permeates our life. He comes in, and the outflow, the inflow of the Holy Spirit, and the outflow of the Holy Spirit. Now get the picture. As long as we stay where Jesus is in control by being obedient to what we understand, all that we understand, as far as we can go, evidently they were doing a lot more at first than they were when John wrote this letter. Now think about it. Many years ago, and I want to use this illustration because I want to hear it again myself. Because I need to be reminded. I remember when the Lord spoke to me and I was preparing to preach a series of sermons when I was at Water Tower in St. Louis. Now this was about 57. This was about 1963 at the Water Tower Baptist Church in North St. Louis. And I was sitting in my living room thinking about this first message. I had already preached on the first chapter that Doris taught this morning in her class about the wonderful God in the book of Revelation. Awesome. The awesomeness of this amazing God that sits on the throne. And I thought, now, I want to be sure I get this message right because this is the first one. And I remembered what I'd heard my dad say, even as a boy, about first love. Now, that's before I knew anything about love as I understand it today. You know, all I could think of was, you know, falling in love and one day getting married and, you know, like all kids do, normal kids. That's questionable today. Normal. What is normal? Well, I believe what's normal is that it wasn't Adam and Steve, it was Adam and Eve. Now, if you don't repent, now look at this. Words of condemnation. If you don't repent, I will come and remove your lampstand, take the light out, the influence, the witness of the church. You know any dead churches around Miami? You've seen them close up. Some of them now are just everything but church. What happened? They left their first love. They stopped doing the first work. How many times have we been admonished at conventions, at pastors' conferences through the years, as I've attended Southern Baptist conferences and the Southern Baptist Convention annual meeting, and we would be admonished at the pastors' conference or maybe in some main message on mission night or something. Have we forgotten that Jesus said we're to go into all the world and preach the gospel? What part are we playing in carrying out the Great Commission as we were admonished this morning? Now keep that in mind as we read this. If you don't repent, I'm going to come and remove the lampstand from its place among the churches. How many strong churches, Tom, you remember back in your lifetime here in Miami? You think about a lot of those strong churches, they're not even in existence anymore. Maybe some other denomination has taken over. A lot of those Southern Baptist churches are now Spanish-speaking churches. They bought the building. Well, now here I was preaching, now get the picture, in a church in a changing community in the 60s, when we were having all the racial upheaval in St. Louis. I thought, what can I say to keep my church on the main track? Because we already had people driving, and I'm not exaggerating when I say 25 and 30 miles one way to church, Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, and sometimes Monday night for visitation. Some of the most faithful people. You know what I learned? It's not the church nearest to you, it's the church dearest to you. I used to walk a mile to my wife's house from where I live after I'd walked a mile to school and then go to church and then walk her home the opposite direction from where I lived. And you know, well, you're crazy. Well, I didn't have a car. I didn't have a motorcycle. I didn't even have a bicycle anymore. I walked. Why did I walk? Because I loved her. But you know something? As I sat there preparing that message on this passage, the Lord said, do you love Doris like you did at first? And about that time, now this is not an exaggeration, my wife called from upstairs. She was getting ready to go to a shower for one of the young brides in our church who was going to have a baby. It was a baby shower. And she had bought a little dress or some piece of clothing that she hadn't wrapped yet. And she yelled down from upstairs, honey, can you come here and help me for a minute? And I thought, boy, I knew it. Just as soon as I got engrossed in it. You know, that's the way the devil works. You know, getting my heart ready for the sermon. My wife calls on me, come upstairs. She said, honey, I need a box to wrap this little dress, I think it was. And you know those boxes upstairs in the attic? Now, we had a big three-story house with a full basement. Now, I'm not exaggerating when I say there were 21 rooms in our house, Tom. 21 rooms in this big old brick house. And she said, I want you to go up to the attic. And there's a box up there with boxes in it. An old Allied van box that we've had ever since we moved in several years before. She'd kept it all these years. She said, would you find me a box, please? She smiled, you know. Well, what was I going to do? I'm studying about first love, you know. The Lord's already convicted me. So I get up there and I open a box and I start looking. And what do you think I found? I found a box of love letters that I had written to my wife from college, my first summer school while she was still working in St. Louis. And I was down there just called to my first church with all that studying and all that sermons to get. And I had made a promise to her now that I would write her a letter every day. Don't ever make that promise. Every day I write her a letter. I did. I wrote her every day. She had all those letters neatly stacked in this box with a ribbon around them, all in chronological order. Well, you know, curiosity killed the cat. I said, I'm gonna read one of those letters. And my wife said, hurry up, honey, I'm in a hurry, I'm late. And I read part of one and I said, oh my goodness, did I say that? Now remember, I'm 16, 17 years old, you know. Did I write that? The Lord said, yeah, you remember? So I hurried, put the box back, put the letters in there. I didn't tell her for several days. And I said, Lord, I got the point. She came downstairs. She said, I haven't got time to kiss you goodbye. See? Now there was a time when she'd have never left without kissing me goodbye. See what had happened? He left her first love. Out the door she went. I thought, I got my illustration. Now I got up the next morning and I preached, Sunday morning, and I preached this message. And the Lord reminded me that sometime before, when I was getting this message on my heart, I went over to the house that we lived in when my dad was pastor in a church in that same community, Northside Baptist Church in North St. Louis. It was there that I gave my heart to the Lord and became a Christian. And I will never forget my best friend, R.L. Hill, lived right across the street, and he was sick with the flu and didn't get to church that morning. And I sat there in my little Ford Thunderbird, and I said, what was the first thing I did, Lord, that morning after I got saved? And this is when I remembered it. I've told this many times, but I remembered that day. As I looked across the street where R.L. Hill used to live, his dad was one of the deacons in our church. We used to walk to school together every morning. And the Lord said, don't you remember the first thing you wanted to do? First thing was to go tell R.L. Hill that you got saved and you wanted him to get saved too. Well now, friends, I'm sorry if I'm taking your time, but I'm here to tell you something. When you care about somebody, especially like Jesus cares, you're going to do just what Jesus would do. Now, I'm not asking for any praise or pats on the back. I'm telling you that it wasn't me who went over that day and said, I want to talk to R.L. And his mother said, well, honey, you may get what he's got. I said, I don't care. I want to talk to him. And I went in and witnessed to him. The next Sunday, he came forward, made his profession of faith, and the following Sunday, both of us were baptized in the same baptistry. Now, why have I taken time tonight when it's time to close to tell you that message or that story of this message? Because I believe that most of us will have to admit that we don't love him like we used to. You see, you can be loyal in your deeds like this church, loyal in your doctrines and hate false teaching. Loyal in your dedication to the work. But you can be lacking in your devotion to Jesus Christ. One great theologian wrote, his title of this message was, Loyal but Lacking. Loyal but lacking. The Lord said, if you don't repent, I'm going to take out the candlestick. Now let me ask you, can churches lose their opportunity? Why is our pastor constantly challenging us with this goal that he has set for all these thousands of people that he wants to reach in this city, in this county, and ultimately in other mission fields and other nations around? South America, Central America, wherever we have a mission. Now this man who's here tonight, challenging these young preachers, these young pastors, encouraging them, helping them, whatever God gives him to do, I don't know. But let me say, my brother, if I have any word, it's this. Don't forsake your first love. I can't tell you how many preachers I knew when they first started out. Oh man, they were going to set the world on fire. Now they're selling insurance. Oh, they're still physically able. But you don't see that light in their eye. You don't sit down and hear him say, man, I want to tell you, the guy I talked to today, man, it was such a great thing, man, I tell you what. Let's pray together. Father, we pray that you'll really convict us about the message from this great chapter in Revelation. Lord, the message that provokes all of us to realize how guilty we can be without even realizing it. Without meaning to, we just get so involved in church work that we forget the work of the church. And Lord, we pray that tonight you'll speak to our hearts. If we're guilty, Lord, help us to repent and return and repeat the first work. Lord, we know there are some listening tonight, perhaps or will be in the days to come, that have also left their first love. And the Lord's love letter speaks to them. I pray in the coming days, they too will repent and return. And to return to the first work that God gave us to do. To go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Please, Lord, motivate us, move us out. Help us to see a lost and a dying world through your eyes. Help us to see like Jesus saw Jerusalem when he said, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how often I would have gathered you as a hen gathers her chickens under her wing. But you wouldn't come." And he wept bitterly. Father, we pray that we'll weep over a lost and dying world. We'll get on our knees and say, "Lord, here am I. Send me." We pray in Jesus' name you'll hear us tonight. And for his sake we ask it all. Amen.
Amen. Did you want to have the invitation now or have Don introduce our...
Yes, would you, Don, introduce?
I'd be very happy.
Thank you.
I got to tweak a little bit, but his role is, he's the pastor of all the small group directors of multiple campuses. So he's not a pastor of pastors, but a pastor of all small group directors.
Small group leader.
Yeah. So
that means he's your pastor, Don.
All right.
Well, yeah. Here's kind of the way it works is each campus has a director. And under the directors are people like me, other directors. So we got a campus leader.
Amen.
He's the head of all those guys.
Well, we need lay preachers. That's what you're doing. That's what we used to call them, lay pastor. Amen. All right, Tom. Now you know who your pastor is.
All right. I want you to double my salary.
That's
the first thing. All right, we're going to have an invitation hymn of Trust and Obey, number 447. We'll sing the first and the last verse of number 447. Then we will be dismissed. Number 447, Trust and Obey. When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. Abide with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. For then in fellowship sweet, sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way
That song says it all, Tom.
It does. It sums it up, doesn't it? All right.
Brother, I want you to lead us in our closing prayer.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day. But Father, what a reminder. What a reminder, Lord, to never forget our first love, Lord. Father, we can echo what the Apostle John said. We love you because you first loved us, Lord.
Yeah.
As we look at that church at Ephesus, Lord, it clearly tells us in the book of Ephesians that it's by grace that we're saved through faith, and that not of ourselves. It is a gift of God, not of works that no one shall boast. Father, that is the love that you extended to us. And while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us and you rescued us, Lord. So, Father, what a great example this man that we got to hear tonight, over 70 years faithfully serving you, Lord. Father, great testimony, Lord, of never forgetting that first love, Lord. Father, let it resonate in our hearts, Lord, that we, that he would pass on the baton to other people here. Father, we would continue the work that he's done for so many years, Lord, the work that you put in our hearts.
Yes.
Because, Father, in your word it says, after Ephesians 2:8-9 and 2:10, it says, for we're your workmanship, created for good works before the foundation of the world, that we should walk in them, Lord. And so, Father, it's our heart's desire, Lord, to continue to do the work you've prepared for us before we even existed, Lord. Father, help us, Lord. Help us, because, Father, even that repentance that we spoke about today is a gift from you, Lord, that comes by grace, Lord. It's your kindness that leads us to repentance, Lord. So, Father, help us to leave here, Father, examining ourselves. If there's any way, Lord, that we have maybe lost that first love and returned to it, Lord. Let us live lives that are pleasing to you, Lord.
Yes.
For your name and for your glory, in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Good night. Thank you.
Welcome our brother here tonight. If you haven't, you're welcome him. We want you to come back, brother, anytime. You can be a regular customer if you want.
God bless you.
CAREY Miller. Look up YouTube, CAREY Miller Ministries. CAREY Miller Ministries.
I got a pop in here.
Oh, I love you, buddy. Well, let me tell you, I try to stay behind the scenes. You know, I'm not competing with the pastor. I tell him I'm complimenting what he does.
Howie.
He's given me a place to preach, and trust me with it.
You've got to bring these young guys in here to see you. What, 70 years? 70 plus years.
No, listen, anytime you bring somebody, he's got a word, you bring them in. Most of them aren't doing anything Sunday night anyway. Hey, okay.
Wasn't that Pastor Allen this morning?